Hi, everybody. It's great to be back here at the Music Academy of the West. I'm doing the addition. I think this might be my 18th summer. And I like to say it seems like only yesterday, but that would be Jessica. Did you ask everybody to come in? It is great to be here with you. I'm asking my students to come here and sit close because No one wanted to play a transcription for solo bassoon of the top of my attempt. What we're not covering today at all is the entire orchestra piece, which is okay. So, if you can see, Jessica is going to play the A2. She's going to give an introduction to the song. She knows what you are. And then we have two of the mainstays of the French bassoon repertoire, and then an arrangement of sort of one of the most popular of the day's songs. So, without wasting too much more time, I'd like to first of all just prepare the students a little bit for what I would like them to do. First of all, I'm not going to cover anything here today that probably has not been covered in some way, I'm talking in terms of large concepts, by some other teacher that they have already encountered. And so I'm going to ask each of you to acknowledge all of the former teachers. The people that have influenced you when you first introduced yourself. Because we're all part of a continuum. In some cases, it has fewer teachers than others, other than me. But I think this is a very important element to understanding yourself in a perspective. I'd like to start this off by acknowledging two of my teachers. The first one I would like to acknowledge is Norman Hertzberg, who was my teacher from the age of about 13 until he died in 2007. So that's a long time. I actually studied with Norman Hertzberg for probably around 8 years and then constantly was in touch with him for decades. He was the student teacher for many years here at the Music Academy of the West. And I spent two extremely productive summers here studying with him, in addition to my time, because I'm from Los Angeles, and he was a figure musician in Los Angeles, and a member of the Warner Brothers Cartoon Orchestra. And if you watch Roadrunner cartoons, you would have heard Norman Hertzberg play the bassoon. And the other teacher I would like to acknowledge is here today, and that is my wife, Janet Ware, who I have learned probably more from than any other person, living or asleep sometimes. So we can see you now, and just I think you're going to go first. And this is what I would like you to do, because I'm going to do it here, okay? I'd like you to introduce yourself. I'd like you to tell us a little bit about your place where you went to school, how you teach. introduce the piece that you were playing, and then tell you how there's something that you love about playing music on the bassoon. Not what you love about playing music, but what you love about playing music on the bassoon. I'll pass you this one. And you want this chair?
No.
Or this chair?
No.
No. You want this, the black one?
Yes.
You want the other one?
My name is Jessica Goldbaum, and I studied at Rice University with Mr. Kamins for my master's degree, and before that I went to the Florida State University and studied with a bassoonist named Jeff Kiesiger. Those were my teachers.
So I'm playing Jean-Cor Etude number 15. This is from a book of etudes that's one of the standard books in our repertoire. Jean-Cor, as you probably guess, is a French composer. That's why I'm playing it today. Something about this etude, which is what you told me the other day, I think fits into talking about kind of our bassoon family, is that this was Norman Hertzberg's favorite etude. And I feel very honored to play it for all of you today because he taught here, and also because his teacher, Simon Kobar, taught here as well. So, yeah, I like this etude. I think it's very lyrical. I think it's of a singer singing it when I play it. And what I like most about playing music on the bassoon is the amount of opportunities I have to play in different styles. So, for example, I get to play music from the Baroque era, and I get to inflect in between notes in a way that like clarinets don't really have the chance to do. But all the way through, let's say, Stravinsky, where he writes music that's very kind of brash and short, and I get to play on really buzzy, bright reeds and just oink. And I can go from sounding so lyrical and so beautiful, and then kind of raunchy and animalistic on a bassoon. So there's lots of opportunities to just get creative on a bassoon. Is that okay? I'm just going to set up a little bit. I'll try and be swift.
There's a lot of paraphernalia when you play the bassoon.
Have you seen this yet?
I've seen something like that. You said it's on
Thank you.
So now if you have to play live for about a year because she's been in Sarajevo on a one-year exchange program with the orchestra there, we've been in, I'd say, sort of contact conversation, but not going to let you do really well.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I appreciate that. Let's talk about
this one. Should we wait this one? Can we talk about this? Oh,
don't
worry. That's okay. You know, it's all downhill from here.
Okay.
So let's look at this a little bit at a time. So what thing I always like to do is look at the left or left-hand corner of the piece and see what it says. Which it says,
Adagio sentimentale.
Adagio sentimentale. Well, I think we know what sentimentale means, right?
Yeah.
Sentimental, right?
Yes.
So adagio, we always like to look at, and adagio is one of those really interesting tempo markets.
Yes, I agree.
Why do you think particularly that?
Well, it's slower than andante, which I consider a walking tempo.
Mm-hmm.
But there's so much kind of wiggle room in an adagio, where it can be, like this says quarter note equals 63, which is just kind of an arbitrary number. But
you know, you remember, because we've spent time on this etude before.
Mm-hmm.
I know we have. It's probably been a while ago. Mm-hmm. That in Jean Paul's books, we take that with a grain of salt, you know, the metronome markings. So what we have in this is that we've got not only a tempo marking of adagio sentimentale, but Jean Horne, who incidentally was one of the great French bassoon players of the 19th century and was played in an opera orchestra. And that's very important to realize because his etudes that he wrote for us are very operatic, which you brought out when you talked about singing.
Mm-hmm.
So we tend to sort of take those. I think he kind of had a strange metronome.
Ah, okay.
Okay, so sometimes they're on, you know, they're off. I don't even remember that from when we went through the book, but it doesn't matter. Adagio literally means at ease, which, as Jessica so rightly pointed out, is very, very arbitrary. Now, something I know about Jessica's background, which she did not share with me, was that she used to be a saxophonist. Or a saxophonist.
Really?
Yeah. She used to be a saxophonist. So Jessica, in France especially, on the saxophone, how do they create vibrato?
They use their jaw. They go, whoa.
Which we don't do that, do we?
Okay. I do that when I'm tired.
Did you do that when you were playing the saxophone?
Yes.
You did. Okay. So what we do is we have an interplay of resistance between the resistance of the instrument and the air, and we get a kind of automatic, it's very much like the fingers together, an automatic sort of quavering of the sound to create a vibrato. Could you play a note without a vibrato for everybody, please? About looking at the tree aside from the fact that it's beautiful, but also it's always changing. So we create this kind of variety in our sound, even on an individual note, and that's one of the ways we do it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, just think of French music. If you could think about how, without even a draw about it, as you describe it, we might want use more vibrato in a way that is more characteristic of French music. And since we're having a class on French music, we want to just sort of look at this just a little bit. So if I play that same A natural. There's a little it's got a little bit more going on. You know what I'm talking. Could you just start by the first phrase and just mess around with that a little bit? So if we're going to play this as an adagio, that sounds really kind of Andante-esque to me.
Okay.
So in other words, can you go a little slower?
Yeah.
What is the dynamic at the beginning?
Piano.
And piano means?
Soft.
Right, so now I want you to not think so much in terms of decibels, but can you get a softer quality to the sound? Because it's a lot easier to learn it when they're 12 than when they're 22. I know, I've taught people when they're 22 and had to change a lot of fingers. Okay. So this is why you came to that. There.
Okay. Should I use it?
But what I want, let me see. You can't get away with it there.
Okay.
Because you know you're sustaining your air through it so that it won't jump down.
Okay,
but what I want you to try now is, first of all, you all understand that we generally start notes with our tongue on the reed. Does everyone know that?
Yes.
If you didn't know that, you do not have to raise your hand. But this is on wind instruments, we generally start notes with our either tongue on the, right behind it, like on the flute, behind their upper teeth, I think. Any flute players here? Is that what they do? I think it's what they do, isn't it? Something like that. And, or clarinet, and the other reads is with our tongue on the reed, and we take it off when we want to start. The air is starting, and we go.
like that, they're going to come up to me. We try not to always sound like that. And one way I help students to try to get in touch with the real beginning of a note is I have to practice breath attacks, and that is the starting a note in the air with no tongue on the reed. So I want you to play just a series of breath attacks in a piano dynamic on that F sharp. Again. And again. Good, okay? So that gets you in touch with it. Now, what you want to do is you can either do that or you can use your tongue but get that quality. Because that gets you in touch with your air actually initiating the note. So let him have a try. Louder or softer? I don't care. Just know what you
want. I want it to be softer.
Okay. Good. Then do that. Make it noticeable. Because we want to get a different color on that E natural so that it gives the variety. If this were an aria, right, and it would be a different word
right.
on that. And so it's akin to creating a different sound as if there was a different word if she was singing it.
Yeah.
What?
Starting
to get sharp. So if you have, or, which is more subtle, right?
I like the first one.
Then do that.
As easily as I could in a fast.
No question, that is true.
Cool.
No question that it would be easier to give direction to the phrase in a faster tempo.
Yeah.
So, what I like to say at a moment like this is, why don't we split the difference?
Okay.
So we're on that natural.
Yeah.
and it made it easier in terms of what you're doing with the ear.
Right.
Just try that.
To go into my bag of like alternate fingerings more often to see if they can help me in terms of intonation. I tend to think of alternate fingerings in terms of like, will it help the note come out rather than will it kind of shade the note in a way that's more like musically appropriate, both in terms of intonation and.
Good. Those are good things to pick up. Thank you.
Thank you.
Kislenko, right? And I will be playing the Francais the same concerto. He only wrote one, so this is it. And then I have to
say a little bit about the Francais.
Okay, the Francais was written in 1979. I believe it was written for the French bassoon, not exactly the German system. It has a lot of notes. It's very noty, and it has, I said this a few weeks ago when I played this, but it has a lot of influences of jazz, and Mr. Michael actually brought this up to me, that it also has a lot of Latin American influence as well.
Where do you go to school, Kyle?
I go to school at the New England Conservatory in Boston, Massachusetts, and I'm a student of Greg Henniger.
Coincidentally, just trying to call me just before the class began.
I texted him, he might be watching this.
What do you love about playing music on the bassoon?
About playing music on the bassoon, I like to play with people, not exactly by myself. So, it's been great working with Natasha and not having to do this alone.
Thank you.
Better you than me. So did you ever see the New Yorker cartoon? The guy sitting in a bar, despondent. The sister's a bartender. She doesn't find my joke funny anymore. The text is the important thing. The lack of plurals is important in that. And this is one of the things that, to me, the response there is, I think he's a one-trick pony, and that is the joke is always the same. But you've got to make sure you really play off the joke, is what I'm saying. Have you noticed that? It's only one joke, and it happens over and over and over and over. Good. So tell us, I'll tell you something. What kind of joke is the point of this movie? Just to be. Just to be. Okay. So is that you a little musician?
Yes.
Did you notice that?
Yeah.
And how old is it?
3 weeks.
3 weeks?
Yeah.
Okay, well, what is it?
I don't play it every game.
This is a good thing. Okay. We need to look at projection, okay? Because one of the things that when you play a concerto is a bassoonist is that you have to be heard over the whole orchestra, and a good composer, of course, will write the piece of it that it works well, and this is actually will work pretty well, but right now the balances are not great, and I don't think it's Natasha's issue, having worked with her in the past. So, would you like to have that movie be more sorry about it, folks, because it's a bassoon, okay? Does everyone here know that the bassoon is a double reed instrument? If you don't know that the bassoon is a double reed instrument, you will not raise your hand. But it is, and what that means is there's two little pieces of wood that you're blowing into, and they vibrate together and they make a sound. Did you make that sound? Fortunately, it doesn't sound like that when you put it on the string. So, what happens is whenever we blow into the instrument, we are going against a certain amount of air resistance. And changing the reed can add or subtract from the amount of air resistance. So if you took the reed off of the tune and you blew through the vocal, then it'd be more or less, it would be take the reed off of the tune and blow through the vocal. That's freer than blowing through the reed, isn't it?
Yeah.
And if you, so this is, I realize this is an obvious statement, but what I'm thinking is that I'm really the obvious, a great deal, because I don't have to hear anything. I found students that if they don't understand one simple thing to say, they won't understand anything that you're saying after that. And so I really try to make sure that it becomes very, very, very basic. So what we're going to do now is without doing anything much at all, I'm going to do a maneuver on trying to be called the laying on of the hand. This is because I imagine. I'm going to take a pad, a little pound steel, and I'm going to put it in concrete, and I'm going to lay it on the ground. Now, this is what I'm going to ask you, which I always ask the student when I've worked on a reed, which I've hardly worked on this one, is you're going to look at that other than it's taking with my hand, and you play a few notes and tell me if it's different than it was. I'm sorry, you put
it in. Yeah.
Okay, now, what other things wanted to change about the reed? You wanted to make it less. Is this
less resistant?
Less resistant. Did you make it less resistant?
Yes.
Okay. Now, would you like to know what really happened there?
Sure.
Okay. All right. First of all, it's a 5-minute set. Okay? They're all about 5 minutes. If you don't know how much more than that, it's quite quick. Okay? What I do is either your fingers, four different things, they're slightly abrasive, aren't they? Very slightly abrasive. I just, by running it over there, I was just rubbing off a little bit of the cane on it and also pressing the fibers down into it, making the clay like I'm taking the cane off of it. Okay. If you're in a spot, remember the rain on the hands, okay? Now, just go back and start at the beginning of this. I'm going to let him put that off. Okay. You're going to have to play now, though. Okay. For projection's sake, could you not let the phrase go down the phrase as you descend? Now, if you want to go jump bump too soft, that's fine, but don't get softer before that.
Okay.
And add a discernible crescendo, that the down to the low E. You have to keep this at the same dynamic. We're going to just start on the low C, okay?
Okay.
And you're going to have to maintain, you really have to sustain that mezzo forte. And you're going to, you'll see when we play, when the touch comes in, the difference is made, okay? Change the color on the A like you did, which is beautiful. But make sure you leave yourself room to do that from the window.
Okay. Where do you...
Okay, wherever you want.
Okay.
And don't... actively don't get softer.
Mm.
It was much better that time, in terms of not being... But it needs to be something that you do intentionally. You see, with tremendous intention. Now let's add Natasha here.
Okay.
And oh, it's that introduction is so long, why don't you start at the beginning?
Yeah.
Okay, and this, I want you to be very discerning about this, okay? I need to be very, very fussy. We don't need to be fussy about everything in our lives, but as soonists, we have to be very, very fussy about our reads. So let me ask you now, do you want to just go opening anywhere? I don't know the answer.
I don't think I do.
Great, that's awesome. I just wanted to make sure we were really on the same page. Now, I have to ask our audience here about the projection this time compared to the first time you played it. Did anyone notice the difference? Could you hear them more clearly?
Yes.
Did that enhance your experience of listening to the concerto?
Yes.
Thank you. Now, I just want to point this out because I know it took you out of your comfort zone. I know it did. I remember one time I was playing the Mozart concerto and I was playing it the way I wanted to, and Janet said, I was out there listening, and she said, I can't hear you well enough. You're going to have to play louder. And I'm thinking, I don't want to play louder. I want to be this musical, you know? And so, but, you know, the reality of it is that the folks got to hear you, right? Okay. So we're going to play. I'm going to start at the beginning again. With this in mind, remember, when you see it right now, you have to then pay attention to that, and with great intention, stay right with it. And I'm going to go out. If you play, why you do that?
Nope.
Whenever I play the piano or anybody else is not playing with you, you know what that means? Freedom. So start it slow, get your bearings. Bump, body, buddy, buddy, buddy. I know her. She'll catch you. But don't play it at a tempo. You can play it. Just start to play it right now. Play it at a tempo. You know you can play it most of the time, okay? exactly where you are. Okay. Good. Now play B bottom, bottom, bottom. Just do that. Before you play in the tempo, you start to hold extra tension in your arms and your hands. Right there? This is what you're going to do. You're going to start right there. And you're not going to begin, don't play this, you're not going to begin until you let go of that tension, that extra tension.
Okay.
Alright? Then you're going to play there at a tempo you can play it easily. And as soon as you feel the extra tension coming back in your arms, your hands are going to stop. Can we mid note? Okay? Okay. Good. Now, we didn't have to ask you to do this. Now, this is not something we can take care of, but this is a very important practice point. What Kai had done is he had learned to play this passage by playing through tension. In other words, the tension comes in at this place, and you feel that, and it's like through sheer determination, he has learned to play this. But what he's really practiced is the tension. He's really practiced playing with that extra tension. So what you're going to have to do when you play this now is to learn to play it again with it with ease. And the only way to do that, as soon as you notice that the tension has come back into it, you have to stop and let go of it. Then you pick it up where you left off. Not back to the beginning, where you left off. You play till it comes back in, and you stop. You have to retrain yourself to play the passage without the extra tension. Because there's a mistake most musicians make. They think when they miss a note that that is the problem. The problem is always, assuming that they know the music. The problem it really is in what comes is when does it creep in? And what you want to notice in your own playing in slow tempo, when you're practicing in a slow tempo, you do practice slow, don't you? Slow tempo is our three things that enter into our playing. And they are hesitation, the playing, all of a sudden there's a moment of hesitation, indecision, or confusion. Now, in practice, when we play, these things enter in all the time. Right? I'm talking nanoseconds of these things. And you have to become extremely observant to see it happening in slow practice. So, those three things, again, were hesitation, indecision, and confusion. And I haven't practiced that. You know what it is? Okay. Hesitation, indecision, and confusion. So play that passage right now and tell me if you notice any of those three things. Starting at 2, on the inner slow tempo. You did, you noticed it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So play it slow until it's not there. I try it really slow. Now you just did it without it, right? Kind of, sort of?
Kind of, sort of.
Kind of, sort of. It was better, right?
Mm-hmm.
That, now you have to take it back there and practice it like that so that when you play it fast, you're playing it as you practice it without unnecessary tension. And as I like to say to them, you might as well do something easy and become a doctor compared to playing it. Now that is a very important concept, okay? And that's an important concept for all of you. And that is hesitation, indecision, confusion. You notice it in slow tempo. It takes tremendous power to discern. Thank you.
afternoon. My name is Frankie Delgado. This is my first year at the Music Academy of the West. This is my classmate pianist, Joseph. Hello, Joseph. I am originally from Las Vegas, Nevada. I did my undergraduate degree at Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland. I studied with Mark DeMeo there, the students in Cleveland. And I did my master's degree at Northwestern University in Chicago and studied with Lewis Kirk and Christopher Millard and David McGill. This piece I'm going to play is by Henri Dutilleux. He's a French composer. This Sarabande and Cortege is one of his early works written in 1942. And there are a lot of influences from Stravinsky to Ravel, even Bartok. Some of his later music has Bartok influences. And this piece is also kind of an example of why I really enjoy playing music on the bassoon. Jessica kind of stole some of my ideas there. But yeah, the bassoon is really kind of a dynamic instrument. It's not as maybe not as demanding as the trumpet, but it's certainly very dynamic. You can go from very bouncy to very lyrical rather quickly, and I kind of enjoy going back and forth between those characters. Okay.
Thank you.
Absolute favorite pieces for bassoon and piano. Doing all right? Should we take a second?
I'm good, yeah. Just a lot of it.
Joseph, what's your last name?
Doherty.
Nice to meet you.
Oh, nice to meet you.
Are you one of the fellows here?
This is collaborative.
First year collaborative fellow. I want you to start this one more time, okay? And I'd like you to think basically through the whole saraband. And this, Frankie, this is also for you. Mm-hmm. You know what a scrim in the theater is? A scrim is a translucent curtain that you sometimes will see in opera, and it creates a veiled effect. You have all experienced a scrim, so that everything you see, all the light you see, all the objects that you see, there's a veiled quality to it. And I need in this saraband, I need a little bit more sense of that quality, so not so percussive, just a little. You want, you know, and have you spent much time playing with bassoon before, Joseph?
Not much, so.
Yeah, the real trick to playing with bassoon, of course, is being careful what you do in the middle registers, you know, in the middle, because, you know, we live in there, and we're, so as Kai said, he likes playing with people because we blend so well, you know, and so you have to be careful in there, but also be very careful with your pedal that it stays clear. All the time. So can we just try this at the beginning so that it makes sense? You remember when I was working with Jessica on the breath attack?
you're not going to be using, you can use breath attacks if you wish, but there's going to have a bit more of this so that attacks, and this is for both of you, attacks are a little, not late or early, but indistinct. So could you stop for a second? Could you take your reed off of the bassoon and put it down right here? Could you finger a low B flat?
A low B flat?
Yeah, finger a low B flat. Could you blow really hard through the vocal? And go thump, thump, thump with your tongue? Thank you. Okay, I just want to make sure we get all of the Rice Krispies out of the instrument. I figure at least when we start the piece, we want to make sure that they're all out.
Right. Okay.
That's better. Now make sure you don't feel like you can't play a phrase, okay? Quite a bit louder than that at that point, right? Uh-huh. And the point, it's pretty early in this piece to get that. And since you so aptly mentioned, there's so much Ravel in this piece, right? Mm-hmm. And so you want to keep that sort of that sort of veil of impressionistic colors going on in it a little bit more than you are.
Okay.
For my taste, it's a little bit too, okay. Mm-hmm. upfront about it, At the same time, I'm not trying to get you to not. It's more, we're just changing the palette. We're not lessening the palette.
Okay.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good. Just play one more time. I want you to just get into the sound and then we'll continue. Try something for me. Try that with a breath attack. Just.
Okay.
Just try it right now. So it's just. Ha da da. And do that again. Good. Now, will you just try one thing? Put your low C sharp key down and do it with that. Tell me how that changes it.
How it changes?
Yeah, how does it change it? It's for the pitch.
Yeah, it raises the pitch.
Does that help you?
Yes.
Okay.
Use it.
Take your time here. Good, that's beautiful. Okay, now you can use your tongue or not use your tongue. I don't care.
Okay.
But we're getting this. You see how there's a less of a distinct beginning to the sound? Not late. I'm not talking about it being late. It's just it's just the beginning of it is it's a bit more veiled. Make sure it doesn't keep being sharp. That was nice on the C and the D, but then you got to be careful on the pitch after that.
Okay.
So, this is not easy. And I'm not trying to get you to blow to not blow. Okay. French vibrato going, that's one of the things, it floats the sound in a different way.
Okay.
Just try that on a note, see if make sure there's enough air behind it so that the pitch doesn't get too distorted. as you're proceeding through this breath, through this phrase, now this has nothing whatsoever to do with getting louder or softer. There has to be an increase in energy to keep the phrase going, whether you get softer or not. Increasing. So have you ever had, there are enough wind players here, have you ever had somebody say, you got to spin the sound?
Oh, yeah.
You've heard this one. Have you all heard that? You got to spin the sound. And you're sitting there thinking, what's that mean? You know? Okay, I finally figured this out. This thing about me keeping energy increasing. So everybody here, don't hit your neighbor. Put your hand out like this. Everybody put your hand out. Harriet, put your arm out. Okay. Now, to keep your arm out, does this, to keep it static, you have to increase the energy, otherwise it's going to go down. Is this correct? We're talking about exactly the same thing. It's the same, the idea is that if you want to keep stasis, if you think you can do it by just keeping something static, but actually it will go down. And so by keeping this, by keeping direction in the phrase, something I want you to mess around with for the next, 10 or 15 years, okay? Good, let's go to the beginning one more time, and I'm going to let you play for a while. Top note in that arpeggio. Frankie, could you do that? I know what you want to do there. Could you do it and not give away the color change away quite as soon as you are?
Oh, okay.
Da-dee-da-da-dee-da-dum. It's there.
Okay, yeah.
Sorry, the note preceding the F sharp is the transition note to the color change. So that I can tell it's going to happen.
Oh, okay.
It'll help you in the long run. This place, change your quality of articulation. Because I know the anime un peu comes at the end of the measure, but it characters changes immediately. We can agree on that, right?
Okay.
So all your quasi-breath attacks that you've been using up to now, that's over for a while. It's alert all of a sudden. You know? It's like you're waking up out of the dream at this point. Start right at that point. It's the measure with the anime un peu. Play quite loud. Just put by yourself. Yeah, right at the, we're on the high A there. But that was, I know this is hard, especially on that reed you're trying to play this on. Could you do that with, and keep the dynamic going through the downslurs?
Oh, yeah.
And notice that those are not. They're not triplets. They're ba da da di da di dum. I need to hear the A, F, D flat, and the B flat. I need to hear that. Okay, take it slow. Yeah, okay, so. I just want you to look at this. It's first of all, it's for the phrase, and it's for projection with the piano.
Okay.
Because, you know, we're going into that register where no one can hear us, right?
Uh-huh.
And so, It even without trying, it's going to sound like it's getting softer because of the registration. So you have to really, you know, keep your juices flowing at that point. Okay. But can we just go from this middle section of the suraband, please?
Here?
Yeah, that's great. I like it with the piano all the way open. I like the sound, but you have to be discreet. Great, go right there, for the cadenzas. Put some vibrato on that high A. You know, you're taking your time, the time here, so the phrase is clear to me.
Oh, yeah.
I hear that. That's good, okay? But in these notes here, it's too straight. You know, you're playing right too much with the beat. I need you to dance with the beat a little bit in there. So the French, they love to dance with the beat. You know, nothing is right on the beat, you know. It's everything is like this, you know? So you have to dance around with the beat.
Okay, okay.
Just from the E-flat. Can I show you something?
Sure.
Well, this was simple. It's in the
British.
Yeah. Make sure you do that piano. We lost Isaac. So while we're waiting for Isaac, what are your questions?
You mentioned the French bassoon. How many kinds of bassoons are there?
Well, in the way you're talking, this is not a brand, okay? This is not a brand, it's not a make. Around the 1830s, when the Industrial Revolution was taking hold, there was a split in actually the actual styles of national styles of the sound and fingering systems of our instrument. And it was at the same time that the flute, the clarinet, and all the other instruments were having their fingering systems perfected. The bassoon actually went two different directions, and you ended up with an instrument, the French bassoon, which has a more, somewhat more nasal penetrating sound compared to the German, which is a somewhat darker, mellower sound. And up through the middle of the 20th century, they coexisted relatively peacefully. In the French country, in France, and the countries where France had some influence, it seemed in Brazil, in Spain, Italy, you saw a lot of French bassoon. England saw a lot of French. And gradually what happened is conductors, bless their hearts, they liked the sound of the German better because it blended better. And so the French bassoon has almost died out. It's still the instrument in the Paris Opera. You still see it in a few other orchestras in France, but you don't see it much anywhere else anymore. I love the French bassoon. And some of the greatest artists in the 20th century played on the French bassoon, and I think it's a shame. Anyway, that's the short form.
I don't know how I'm supposed to follow those two. I'll give it a go.
Give it a go, Isaac.
My name is Isaac Schultz. I attend Rice University in Houston, Texas, where I study with Mr. Kamins, who's my main teacher. This is Nathan, my friend and pianist. I'll be playing an arrangement by Mr. Kamins of The Girl with Flaxen Hair by Debussy. This is one of Debussy's most famous piano preludes and is really one of the best known works from the Impressionistic period. There's a lot of interesting harmonies going on at the same time as a luxurious, peaceful melody. Oh, love about playing bassoon. One interesting thing that I found with bassoon is that because there are so many things going on everywhere with the reed and all of this stuff, that when it comes down to it, when I stick it in my face and start going, I don't really know what's going to come out the other side. You can never really be sure. However, it's always an adventure playing the bassoon, and that's something that I really appreciate. So.
Thank you.
why did, when I did this arrangement, did I keep it in that key? Would you tell everybody what key this is?
This key is in, it's in G flat.
G flat major.
Which creates some problems because the first phrase on piano would go like dee 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 dee, and
what does it do on bassoon?
One thing on bassoon, it goes.
It's indescribable, isn't it?
Yeah, it's. Every single one of those notes requires at least 8 different fingers, and they're usually in different positions.
However,
Nathan,
yes. Right? What is one thing on keyboard, flat, when you have a lot of black keys like that, mm-hmm. that makes it easier, doesn't it?
It's nice, actually, yeah.
Yeah, it's so this is a piano piece, and so on piano, that all lays beautifully, doesn't it?
Yeah, either all white or all black, it's very comfortable.
It's very comfortable, that's right. And there are, this is not the first arrangement of this piece for every instrument in the world, you know, existence. Everybody plays this piece. So. Boy, this is a really good chair. Must be a cello chair. Is that a cello chair?
It's so good.
God. Woo. I give up. So I left it in that key because I think it sounds better in that key because that's where he wrote it, right? Mm-hmm. And you played that, you did fabulously. Now, look at some of the words. What does it say at the very beginning?
Sans rigueur.
And what does that mean?
Not too rigorously, not too fast.
Right, it would be just, let's lay back into it, okay? Mm-hmm. Really lay back into it. So this we have to play, because it's a piano piece also, let's look at something that is interesting about the piano, which is different than a wind instrument. Nathan, play a note and hold your finger down on it. So what happens?
The sound dies.
The sound dies away, doesn't it? The piano cannot sustain a single note. Is this not true?
Yes.
And you spend a great deal of time trying to give the impression that you do sustain. Is that not true?
Always.
So they are always trying to do musical sleight of hand to show that they do sustain. But what you have to notice in this piece is that when they play, they cannot sustain. Now, I am not going to ask you to play with no sostenuto in your playing, but the sostenuto in your playing has got to be of a very light quality. So let's just play the opening phrase. And don't blow through it quite so much. You know what I mean? But at the same time, the air is that it's just not dissimilar to what we were doing with Frankie. Have you ever played this piece on the piano?
Before.
Now, will you play the first phrase? You can't figure out why did he do that? That you decided not to do. Because you know why? Because if you were to play that on the piano, you would have to go.
Oh, I thought that was a typo.
No, it was not a typo. It was very intentional because it changes the whole pacing of how you hit that E flat.
Yeah.
Because they have to roll that. Is that not correct?
Yeah.
There's no way anybody, last time I checked, no one can stretch quite that far with their hand. Okay, so. Now, what I want you to do is, I don't want you now to back away from putting color and phrase into this. Okay, that's not what I'm talking about. It's. But you know, that was beautiful. Now, I want you to go from the E flat, this is the pickup into measure 1, 2, 3, 4, pickups into measure 5.
Take your time.
Here, you just let that one sound.
Okay.
And then you come on. Did your parents get caught in the bassoon?
Yeah.
Oh. I hate it when that happens. So what do we went to there's tempo rubato. Do you remember? Have you all heard the expression tempo rubato? Tempo rubato is the Robin Hood of the music world. Do you know why it's the Robin Hood of the music world? We steal from the rich and give to the poor. So we take time away from one place and give it to another place. But the ultimate pulse stays the same. It's different than playing freely. Somebody. Keep the phrase going. Because otherwise you're going to, okay? That's good, okay? Now go from the B flat, measure 7. This little motive comes to be, you have to return to being without rigor.
Okay.
Because it's this motivic, this motive here. You know? So if you have So again, like we're talking with Frankie, it's always, we're dancing with the beat, right? Dancing with the stars, okay. We're dancing with the beat. The point is that that's what the French always done. You know, in French Baroque,
yeah.
You have this, the concept of inégal in French Baroque, which is, you know, you don't play two notes the same in the same time, right behind, you know, sometimes people do it as a dotted rhythm, but in reality, it's somewhere in between, and it's kind of like this. Okay, so this has been a tradition in French music, you know, for hundreds of years. And it still exists in French performance. It's just much more subtle. But rarely do they're always, it's just always a little bit off. It's very different than playing German music. Yeah. Start wherever you want.
I'm going to start from the middle of 15.
at home, and the 16th. So okay. The 16th's got to be at that point. It sets up the caesura then better.
Okay.
I want to hear your high E flat again.
Oh, low.
Start from your low B flat. For these extraordinary young people. I feel incredibly lucky to be given this opportunity to spend 4 weeks of my summer working with these people. I want to say that.
About as lucky as we are.
Oh, I don't know about that, Isaac. Next week, I have decided to embrace the inevitable. And our class is going to be called The Clown of the Orchestra. If you can't beat them, join them. And will be humorous works for bassoon. I know that you won't want to miss a single one of these, and because at the very end, they're going to perform a bassoon quartet by Peter Schickele known as The Last Tango in Bayreuth, which is worth the price of admission alone, and considering this is one of the free classes, what more can I say? Thank you for coming.